start at 8, so I don't think we're going to get much of an interview. Would you rather, do you want to do it in the 20 minutes we have left, or would, do you want to reschedule for another night?
Oh, might as well do it 20 minutes.
Okay, we'll do the 20-minute version. Adam, you want to hang out or you want to leave?
Sure, sure. Arthur, I'm the Tony Randall of this show.
Yeah. Okay. That's exactly what he is.
I show up when a guest is not available. So.
So prepare to have your mind blown then, Adam. Okay. Arthur is an investigative historian who discovered an ancient science which is revolutionizing the way we look at history. So much history has been distorted or hidden. The ancient science used by our scientists as far back as 32,000 BC is revealing astonishing facts about forgotten history. Now, if that should blow your mind, because it blows my mind. Now, I have to say that I recently got my medical marijuana card and have been just trying it out for the first time. And so that confuses me as if I just smoked a bowl just now. Explain to me what that means, Arthur.
What, medical marijuana?
No, the investigative historian discovering ancient okay. science, which is revolutionizing the way we look at history.
Yeah, well, years ago, I started doing my family history, and I learned that our family was high up on the Celtic Templar hierarchy. And while exploring that, I also learned that there was an ancient science called geoglyphology that had been used for tens of thousands of years to mark territories and to indicate places where they were important to the people that placed the geoglyphs on the ground. Now, geoglyphology is nothing more than surveying geoglyphs such as at Nazca and see where they go, because these geoglyphs have irregular sides, they have lines that point in different directions. They have buildings with walls that are not parallel and such as that. And then each one of these you can extend out to an important point that was important to the people that built them. And by doing this, you can go back and follow their history down through time and determine a lot of history that has been suppressed or overlooked. So what I'm talking about is geoglyphology. Go ahead.
You're talking about the things like the Nazca lines and things like that?
Yes, especially not so much the lines, although they could play into this, especially the geomorphic figures like the hummingbird and the other figures on there. Like, for instance, the straight lines on the feathers of the hummingbird are geoglyphic lines that, if you extend them, go to some important places.
Like what? Like, give me one big takeaway, something you've discovered from using these, tracing the lines okay. as far as they go.
You heard of the Yonaguni Pyramid in Japan?
Yes.
Okay. That's one of the first things that I surveyed. And it's on about 300 feet underneath the ocean where 8,000 years ago, or 8,000 BC, it was above water. Either the water rose or that land sank. But anyway, it's underwater right now. And the Yonaguni Pyramid is the perfect example of a geoglyph that's not what you would think it would be. The cuts in the stone of the pyramid, if you extend them out and go to the endpoints that are determined by the protocols that live within geoglyphology, you'll find a territory. You'll find a territory that is the Japanese Empire back in 8,000 BC.
Wow. So this is a picture of what you're talking about here. I don't know how well people can see it. It's probably pretty small.
Yeah, it looks good. Yeah, I can see it.
Yeah. So is this something, what you're doing, is that... is it generally accepted by mainstream science or in history? Are all these things that you're coming up with, or is there a lot of, I don't know, objection to any of what you're saying?
No, there's absolutely no objection to it. There was some when I first started because it was new. People weren't familiar with it. But I've been doing it for 14 years, publishing articles on the subject. And my website, the Faram Foundation, .com, has a link on there to where you can go, and it gives you a lesson on how to the protocols and everything on this. So it is well established now and easy to reproduce, and anyone can prove that it works.
Oh, well, I think the question I would probably get, Adam, Tony, you'll appreciate this. The question, how can you be talking about things that happened 8,000 years ago? Isn't the Earth only 5,000 years old?
What are you talking about? The Yangoni Pyramid?
I'm just kidding. Yeah. Okay. Whatever.
He's making a terrible creationist joke.
Yeah.
Okay.
If the Earth is only 5,000 or 6,000 years old, I mean, you're talking about going about 32,000 years, or 34,000 years in some of the cases. That's mm-hmm. That's before the Earth even existed.
Oh, no. The Earth is 4.5 billion years old.
Oh. I guess I've been misled.
Yeah. Tony, Matt is of the belief he spends his summers at the Creationist Museum in Kentucky.
So he believes
that man rode dinosaurs. So
really. So I'm looking over your website there, and there's a whole bunch of places that you've got documented here. Some of them pretty you wouldn't expect to find any of this stuff. There's like I'm not sure if this is a pyramid or not in the Antarctic.
Yeah, that's a pyramid. That's a stone pyramid that's been carved out.
That alone, even if you don't have any glyphs that are pointing to anywhere, just having a pyramid in that part of the world is a surprising enough find that it should be on the news and should be more commonly known, no?
Well, let me tell you, for some reason, there's some organization, a worldwide organization, that doesn't want us to know about these things, and they've been successful in suppressing them until the internet came along and Google Earth. So now anybody and his dog can go around and find these things.
So that's interesting because I've been. What would you classify this study as? Is it archaeology? Is it anthropology? What is it?
It's geoglyphology. Geo for earth, glyph for glyph, and ology means to study. So it's geoglyphology. Now there's another science that has just come about that uses some of these same structures I'm surveying. And it's called archaeoastronomy. And they take these lines that I'm dealing with and use them in regard to the positions of the stars. And by doing that, they claim they can date the structure by when the stars, how it relates to the stars when it was built, say 5,000 years ago, it can tell when it was built. So there's other ways you can manipulate these things.
Are you allowed to mention the name of the group that didn't want your research out there? Or do you not want to draw their ire?
Well, I've said it before, so I'll say it again. Every piece of research on a geoglyph that I've put out there, the geoglyph has either been modified or destroyed. I can say this with some accuracy, because I have seen property that Masons own, Freemasons. I've seen them build a geoglyph there. I've surveyed it to determine what they meant, published it, and it will disappear within a matter of days or weeks. So it's my impression that it's the Freemasons, for some reason, that do not want this ancient wisdom to be known. And if it's not the Freemasons, I'm sorry, but that's the only one I've come across so far.
Well, I like that. If it's not the Freemasons, I'm sorry, but I've never heard
that. It's the Stonecutters, if it's not them, right? It's the Stonecutters. They made Steve Gutenberg a star, and they're trying to take your livelihood away from you.
Well, I got to give you credit on that, though. I know Tony Randall over there is making a little bit of fun on that, but most people, when they are asked to give the who the they is in a theory like that, they won't say anything. You know, it'll always remain they. At least you
kind of gave. I remained silent on that for about 12 years, but since then I've proved to myself that that's who I'm looking at.
I've always been confused by this idea of Freemasonry because I think I can join the Masons. Can I join Freemasonry and then be part of them and then infiltrate the whole thing and figure it all out?
You're a good character and you tell them that you believe in the supreme being, then you can join.
Hmm. Well, because this is what I thought about this, because the stuff that you're proposing here now, all this stuff, you can't see them from these lines. You can't see them from the ground level, right? You have to be elevated.
For the most part, yes.
So it suggests that 5,000 years ago, people had some kind of flight, or there were UFO aliens, or
do we have more than 15 minutes? I'll tell you what.
Sure, please.
Okay. Good. 300,000 years ago, the Japanese, in their oral history, say that there was a group of people from another planet that came here because their planet was dying. Now, strangely enough, Mars, this dirt on Mars, has been aged to 300,000 years ago because of the radioisotopes that remains in it. So they're saying that there was probably a nuclear war 300,000 years ago in Mars. Now, it just so happens that these texts from Japan say that these people came over to the Earth 300,000 years ago. So there may be some connection there. I don't know. But anyway, the people that came here with the idea of educating human beings and giving them knowledge. They also had flying machines that allowed them to go from territory to territory, educating the people on the Earth. And the people back then called them gods. Whether you want to call them gods or astronauts, whatever you want to call them, that's up to you. I have no preference myself. But that's my take on it.
You believe that story? I mean, I hate to put it that way. It sounds like I'm putting you down. I'm just saying, do you have to believe in it? That's what I'm saying.
It sounds kind of far-fetched. But with the research I've done, I'm convinced that there are people even today that are coming here from other planets. And like many people believe, I'm not so sure there's not some living here amongst us.
So there is a renewed interest in UFOs, no doubt. And people are talking about it a lot lately. But the idea of the lines being created for the purpose that you can only see them from the sky.
I was going to touch on that, and it slipped my mind. These people, when they came here, they had spacecraft, actually. And they would travel from territory to territory, educating the populace. Now, when somewhere around the time that the Anunnaki came here and messed everything up, they were using these spacecraft, and sometime since then, some bad players have messed up the relationship of man and Earth. And excuse me for a moment, because I get hypoxia because I only have one lung.
Oh.
So I have to take a breath.
Gotcha. Well, don't overwork that one lung. Believe me, I'll talk until you catch your breath. Adam will. I mean, Tony.
Yeah, well, I'm always curious because you have a couple of books on Amazon and you have reviews here, most of which are positive and some of which are a little bit negative. Do you ever feel the need to respond to something like, there's this one on, you have a book called La America.
Right.
And it says, interesting book, but I still haven't decided if I believe it. The pictures and maps are awful and do not convincingly support the claims in the book. Sometimes I think the author is seeing things that aren't there. Probably a grain of truth in all this. I read it through and filed it away in memory as possible unproven theory.
That's a valid comment, one which I do not share.
But do you ever get, I mean, that's a 3-star review. I mean, you know, do you ever get the urge to go, hey, wait a minute, I said this, blah, blah, you know,
very far out there, and hard to understand concept that I'm trying to put across here. Mm-hmm. And one thing that I do, and I think I'm pretty successful at it, is I try not to say anything that I can't back up with physical evidence of some sort, or at least a very credible document. So, yeah, there's going to be people, I don't care what you do, there's going to be people that say stuff like that. But for the most part, it's been very well received. And it is provable. And I mean, that's the which proves that science is a science, because you can reproduce it. So,
well, I think we'll be good cop, bad cop. Tony, you're obviously the bad cop.
No, I was asking if he got the urge to respond to something like that. I have no opinion on his work.
Because my comment on that is, if can you see if that's a verified, somebody who actually bought the book, or somebody who just...
Let's see what it says. Verified purchase.
Oh, there is verified purchase. That's important. It was about
2 weeks ago.
Okay. Arthur, please don't take this in a personal way at all. I mentioned this before you were on the air, that I saw some of the YouTube videos, and my opinion on that is, that guy's opinion of the book or whatever, or the pictures that you have, are not going to be unusual, because I don't think the presentation style is all that eye candy or short attention span theater, YouTube friendly, 2021 MTV enough for a lot of people. It's like a whiteboard type lecture on YouTube, and I think that you could lose a lot of people who were, if they were looking at this as, you know, for serious inquiry, just the presentation style of the YouTube videos alone would tend to turn a lot of those people right off. And he's right about when he talked about the quality of the pictures. I looked at some of the pictures and I was like, well, I'm not sure I could see what you're talking about now.
You're right. But see, I don't have a sponsor. I have to do all this stuff myself.
I know. It's a pain in the ass.
But you're exactly right. I know what you mean.
So presentation part of it is important, why it's not like more television friendly and, you know, like Ancient Aliens type of stuff. But when you talk about being able to back this stuff up, and you said with physical evidence, and I don't know if you saw my Facebook, physical evidence of a lot of this stuff must be difficult. But then you followed it up with, or a document, a supporting document, which I can see. So supporting documents are pretty easy in the digital age to come up with.
In the vein of what you're just saying, physical evidence, if you were to find one of these geoglyphs on the ground, and I can show you some all over the world, and you sit down at one of these legs that is projected from the geoglyph, and you get a magnetic compass and find out the direction of this leg. Now let's see if we got any. Yeah. There's one. The bottom one that says Mexico.
Right.
It's projecting straight lines on that centerpiece. What it's doing. But if you were to take and project one of those lines out to some place that meets the protocol of geoglyphology, you would find that it works every time. And that's the kind of proof that I'm trying to put across. You can't deny something that works every time that you try it, once you've known the protocols.
Gotcha. So, but now, have you ever, the natural question is why, right? And because you're talking about, like, with the Japanese, I'm going to call it a myth, because 300,000 years ago sounds like a myth to me. But with the Japanese myth, up until the stories of 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, whatever it is, that's a long time span for people to continue to draw these lines. Have you ever thought, you know, considered the question why, and do you have an idea on why?
Well, the current batch that was done after the last ice age, one of which is the Yonaguni Pyramid, the current batch, and there's batches go back before that, seem to be associated with the constitution of the human race on the planet. Around the time that Yanaguni was built, there was many other ones built around the world that have connections to the replenishment of human beings on the earth. And this can be determined by the type of symbols that are on the structures around what I'm talking about. Now, a good example at Yanaguni and many other places around the world, you'll have people, the people holding their stomachs with both hands. That's like Göbekli Tepe, and it's indelibly etched onto the vertical posts within the pits. Those are birthing pits to where people were impregnated under sacred conditions with ceremonies to reproduce. And those are all over the world, and they all have the same symbols. Now, there's a symbol down at the bottom of one of those vertical posts that go Göbekli Tepe. It looks like two horseshoes opposing each other with a spiral in the middle. That particular symbol is the symbol for a man and a woman having sex. And that also appears at all these sites that I'm talking about. Now, on the top of the Yanaguni pyramid, there are two phallic symbols perfectly engraved on the top of the Yanaguni pyramid. One is the male genitalia, the other is the female genitalia, matching, doing what they do. And these birthing sites repeat themselves all over the world. So it's a matter of research and putting these things together.
The female genitalia, can you describe it a little more visually? Just kidding.
Were you close? That's all it took, just the description?
The FaramFoundation.com. You click on Yanaguni, you'll see.
Well, that's what. Do you have high res images of all this stuff?
Because yeah. That one is kind of high res.
Just because, you know, you talked about proof and all this stuff, I think, you know, it seems a kind of, it doesn't take that much to get people to have a lot of sex and reproduce, at least I guess birth rates have fallen off now. I don't know why, what that is attributed to, but.
No, what I was alluding to that I didn't put across to you is that with these birthing sites, they're also associated these flying machines that I was telling you about. So it appears to me that every time we have an apocalypse, like the Great Ice Age, these ones that came out about 8 to 10,000 BC show up. And there's little apartments around each one of these sites that I'm telling you about that looks like apartments for people to raise a child in before they're sent to someplace else. And they all have those too. So all these same things keep appearing at these birthing sites all over the world.
Well, maybe it was just a prehistoric, or I guess prehistoric, maternity ward. That's where you would have.
Basically, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Tony, you got anything on this?
Well,
he's flabbergasted.
No, I was going to answer your question about the birthing rate. I think it's lower because people's college loans are hanging over their head, and they don't have the money, and they don't think, I can't buy a house, and I shouldn't have children because I can't afford it.
Well, and back then, they'd all been destroyed by some apocalypse.
Right. What? I think that's unrelated to their college loans, though.
I heard another theory. And this theory, I give a little more credence than the college loan theory. Although it's not a terrible, but I had a college loan too, and I still have kids.
Was it $200,000 and hanging over your head and
it was hanging over my head. It wasn't $200,000, but it took me till 43 to pay it off.
Yeah.
But I heard the theory that it's radiation from cell phones. That young guys, they either wear it on their belt or put it in their pocket, and the radiation from the cell phones is decreasing semen production. That's what I heard. No,
I was more thinking in the practical sense of you don't want to have children, and also the notion of
right. No, I was thinking
prophylactics being a little easier to come by.
Yeah, but you know, guy, and I'm sorry to Arthur to kind of skew this conversation, but you know, guys aren't really condom friendly that much. I mean, they were during the you know, the AIDS hysteria stuff. People were condom crazy. I don't think you can find a lot of young men, 21 years old, ready to put on a rubber.
Well, but perhaps women might be more prepared with their own forms of birth control.
And all right. So you think it's more desire. I'm wondering more.
Well,
more
I'm one who doesn't have children for the reasons I've basically just described, even though I don't have a college loan. But, you know, I've never wanted children. But I know lots of people who didn't do it for the same reason that I, you know.
But I know a lot of people. And again, I will go back to the Arthur's stuff in a minute. But I know a lot of people who intentionally didn't want children and still had them anyway because it just happens sometimes. No, it is that. So, Arthur, back to – oh, I'm sorry.
Children are God's way of punishing us for having sex.
That's true. but the lines and stuff. So, but the point I was making before, it happened, according to your research here, happened over hundreds of thousands of years. So these aliens have been kind of revisiting and redoing the lines and putting them all over the world for that long. It just seems like a lot of work for to have to decipher this stuff in such a long, hard, tedious way. Why not just write a note?
I'm not. I don't know why they prolong it, and there's bound to be some reason. Obviously, they don't hate us, so they destroyed us. It appears that they reconstitute us every time we disappear. So you'll have to ask them why they keep on doing it. The thing about it is that, and I've coined a phrase. You know, people have not been able to follow this down through eons to this point because they home in on the culture or the name of the culture. What I have done is I follow, starting at the beginning in Japan and following it down to present day, I follow the symbols and the spiritual practices of these people, which always match, and they have been in continuity from back from the first time that these people started passing these traditions down to today for, you know, hundreds of thousands of years. So that's how I follow them and how I validate the fact that they started back then and they are continuous until now. So somebody out there likes us and keeps bringing us back from the brink of extinction.
Well, that's an interesting. Somebody out there likes us. So, are you a believer in? When you say that, are you a believer in God, or is it these aliens that you're talking about?
Well, I'm a believer in both. God is the vibrations that take place throughout the universe that allows us to become physical and have rocks and other animals and ourselves. That's God. God is eternal. God is everywhere. What was the other thing you were talking about?
Whether you believed in that it was God or aliens. Because you said, well, when somebody out there likes us,
wasn't
sure whether you meant.
Well, that would be the aliens. And of course, the ancient people called them gods, but because they didn't understand who they were.
They keep bringing us back from extinction. So we've been at that brink more than once.
Many times. Many, many times.
Good. Cuban Missile Crisis, maybe?
What's that?
Cuban Missile Crisis, was that one of them?
No. No, we're talking about ice ages.
Okay.
The asteroid that destroyed the dinosaurs. They go back, I think there's been like 5, 6, 7 of them.
Was it an asteroid that destroyed dinosaurs? I think there's some conflicting stories on that too. That they evolved into just became smaller, and what we see now as a turkey is really T-Rex. I mean, so I mean, I've heard that asteroid story too. You know anything about that, Tony?
Oh, I thought they just ate some bad curry and it just it got out of control.
No, they ate those bad cowboys that were riding the dinosaurs. Yes. The dinosaur cowboys.
Yes, they were made of tryptophan, so they've been asleep the whole time.
Right,
they're not actually turkeys.
Hey, there's something interesting you're talking about. In Indonesia, right at this very minute, there's a temple there, which I don't know how old it is. Can't be more than a couple thousand years old. That has engraved on the entrance a Tyrannosaurus.
Wow. What do you make of that? What does that mean?
Well, they didn't have history books, so that must mean that there had to be Tyrannosauruses around at the time that they built that temple. Of course, it's way out in the jungle. It's not inconceivable there could be anything running around there.
Yeah, that's one way to interpret it, but we have pictures of T-Rexes and stuff, but they haven't been around in our time. Of course, we found fossils, put them together, and then drew pictures from them. So...
So either they were advanced than we are today.
There's debate on all this stuff too. I mean, you'll find people, and I'm not one of them, who believe in very advanced ancient civilizations here on Earth. I don't know. I haven't seen any real evidence of that. You have?
Oh yes, many times.
Advanced civilization. Can you give me an example? I mean, I know the pyramids kind of are mind blowing. I mean, obviously there's some advancement there, but is that any more advanced than like a B-52 bomber or something?
How about a Chinese pyramid that's 100,000 years old with copper plumbing in it? And one of the things about pyramids, they don't work. They're supposed to be energy machines. They don't work fully functionally unless you have water running through them. So here is a 100,000-year-old Chinese pyramid with water running being pumped through it.
There's definitely
stuff like that.
Absolutely impressive if that's the case. I haven't seen that. You have?
Oh yeah. But I can't bring them up out of my head, but I've seen
right. No, but that's impressive enough. But still, I would say that that's advanced for 100,000 years ago, no doubt about it. That would really shock me and say, "Wow, that's really impressive work." But that's not anything compared to an iPad. Or an iPhone.
Is there a picture of this pyramid, the Chinese pyramid, on your website somewhere?
No, it's you can look up somewhere. I've got 14 years of research. I can't remember everything. Oh, I just put it up here, but I couldn't tell you where it's at.
Well, I have a television studio right here. You know, complete television audio recording studio, camera, and communications device. A brick building with copper plumbing, and it seems advanced, but not. It's no iPhone.
Well, they keep in these coal mines. You've seen these, I'm sure. In these coal mines, down at the levels where there were like 80,000-100,000 years old deposits, they find spark plugs. There's another place in India, I think, where they're finding springs in these places where they shouldn't be. I mean, we're talking like 300, 400 feet below ground. They start digging in these deposits and they find stuff, modern stuff in there. I mean, where did it come from?
Yeah. Well,
my idea is we keep repeating the same thing over and over again. And these, because of the apocalypses, we have these people up there that have the knowledge that didn't disappear because they're up there and we're down here. And they come back and they start us up with this stuff all over again. And we just keep going through the same phases.
Wow. So the thing about
Atlantis, if Atlantis is true, there you go. There's one example right there.
Well, I've heard of Atlantis a lot. And to be honest with you, I actually worked for a lady who channeled a guide from Atlantis, a spiritual guide, who his name was Haywin, and he came from Atlantis to talk to 1,200 people who paid a lot of money to hear what he had to say. So I've heard of Atlantis, but I've never really seen it, but I know somebody from Atlantis in a weird kind of way. I don't necessarily know that that's real either. Not just myth.
Oh, I don't either. But if it is, it's an example of what we're talking about.
Right. The thing that you got me really interested, and this is kind of funny in a weird, stupid way, but that's me. I'm weird and stupid and funny. Spark plugs would have to indicate that at some point they had a combustion engine that was in similar in design to what we have today. Now, the odds of any civilization even rebuilding itself and coming up with that kind of quirky, meticulous design and then repeating it again in the last 100 years.
Let me tell you something. There's been many, many artifacts found in Colombia. They're made out of gold that are in the form of modern aircraft. They have taken these gold objects and built models, you know, balsa wood and paper models to the exact design of these gold artifacts. They put a small motor on them and they fly. They fly just like a modern airplane. They look like a modern airplane. They fly like a modern airplane. So there's another good example of something that happened thousands of years ago that is just now happening for us right now. It's not inconceivable that if we keep coming back and the same people bring us back, that they start us out on the same level, a lower level, and start building us back up to where we were before. And it's not inconceivable that they would give us the same information.
Yeah, no, I don't, that's not inconceivable. It's just why we would, because my whole point there is the combustion engine is not an eloquent
thing. Oh no, that's a thing.
Why would we keep building the same clunky piece of crap in experience after experience of lifetime after lifetime, or civilization after civilization, keep coming up with the same bad ideas? So many
times. Exactly.
Are you saying, like, in ancient civilizations, there was also some sort of lie known as clean coal, where someone would try to sell the idea that, oh, you know what, we can just do a clean version of coal? Was that another source of energy at the time, too, that they're just teaching us new versions?
What happened, I think the way I heard it was they take the coal out and they clean it, so now you have clean coal. That's the way I've heard it said.
Okay, that makes just as much sense.
They're pulling it out of the ground. They're cleaning it, and now it's clean like you've never seen before. Clean. We're gonna have the cleanest air. You cleaner than clean air. It'll be almost too clean. Like you breathe it, and you'll say,
"You got my website." You're coming across the bottom. Great.
Yep.
Yeah. So the Faram Foundation, and what is exactly the mission of your foundation, Arthur?
It's to bring forth ancient history. That's about it. And because much of the stuff I found has been hidden away for so long, and we're entering into an age where the truth is becoming more important than the untruth. And it's my, I fear it's my job, my mission, to bring forth from the ancient past the things that I can bring forth and show people that we aren't unique. We're just the same people that we have been for millions of years.
Wow. That kind of goes back to what we were talking about before you came in the room.
Part about trolling? Which part?
Yeah. About you don't believe people can change. Well, people can't change, and neither can civilization change. It's just the same kind of.
How do you view a book or a movie like Contact, which kind of deals with both aliens and God, sort of treating them on equal ground?
Well, I've found that a lot of you remember I told you that the Freemasons. Mm-hmm. Know a lot about this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, and years ago, back in thousands of years ago, they called them, well, you've heard of Merlin in King Arthur's court, right?
Oh, I love Merlin stories, man. That's okay. My favorite story from
Merlin. Merlin practiced the ancient spirituality. And back then they called them magicians instead of prophets. So when you think of Merlin, think of him as a prophet instead of a magician, because that's what they called them back then. But that's the kind of people that have the ancient knowledge of the past.
Wow.
I thought Merlin was fictional. I mean, nobody's perfect, but...
No, he's not. Neither is King Arthur.
Yeah, I think there is some historical basis for King Arthur, but it's a lot of...
My genealogy proves it out.
Well, that is an interesting story, and believe me, I'm a big fan of the Arthur story. Some, you know, there are different accounts on who the actual story was based on, whether it's named mm-hmm. Arthur, all that kind of stuff. But I believe Merlin was based on a series of people. I'm not sure about that. You know, I was a lot more educated on that subject 20 years ago. I have like vague memories right now. And as I mentioned, I did start medical marijuana this week, so I'm trying to remember what I knew about Merlin, but it's not coming back. But I do think there was some basis for...
What medical problem is it you're trying to solve?
Yeah.
Remembering?
Yeah. I do think there was some basis for the Merlin. I won't call it a myth. I want to say it's a compilation of many different historical figures.
That's possible. But the point I wanted to make is that a lot of times down through stories you read through history about ancient myths, ancient history, they mention a magician. And when they say a magician, that's all I'm trying to point out is that means the ancient person that had the wisdom.
Well, yeah.
A medicine man for the Native Americans. Good point. Same thing.
Yeah, don't mind Tony. He's a skeptic on everything. He would never believe in Merlin the magician. He just.
Well, if you're telling me he's a composite character anyway.
Yeah, a composite magician. Kind of like Penn, Teller, all those guys.
David Blaine, yeah. And Blaine.
And Chris Angel, all in one. Yeah. All in one. Well, Arthur, so let's wrap this up. What's your plans? You doing some kind of a presentation soon? You're selling books? What's coming up for you?
Oh, on Saturday, and I don't have the time. You're going to have to look it up. But on Saturday, on Cliff Dunn presentation, I'll be on a 1-hour interview on his show. So this is Saturday, Cliff Dunn. You have to look it up somehow.
Yeah, I'll find it. Is it on your website at all?
No, I just did the interview a few minutes ago.
Oh, okay.
So I haven't had a chance to do anything with it yet.
Okay. So that's why you were late coming to my show.
Well, no, you told me 8 o'clock, I thought.
So. Yeah, 8 o'clock. You showed up at 8:40.
Don't worry.
Oh, you were going by Houston time, so you thought you were 20 minutes early.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, time zone stuff will screw you up. I wonder if the aliens had time zones. They had something. They had to know about time zones. They drew these lines.
That's another thing I haven't mentioned, is that these territories that major geoglyphs make, they fit together all over the world like a giant puzzle. So they have to be legitimate.
So they all connect every single instance of these lines and glyphs that you're finding around the planet. They all connect at some point.
Not every glyph, but the major ones that form giant territories. They all fit together.
See that goes back to the why. It's just like why, man. Why? What is it? What do we get out of having them?
Well, these were originally the territories that certain individuals.
So like nationalism.
Yeah. Well, they were territories and they were teaching areas. That was the area that certain individuals of the aliens, if you want to call them that, went to teach. They had each territory had somebody to go teach there.
Right. Wow. Interesting stuff to say the least. Got any, final questions, Tony, or?
Well, he should pitch his book, not pitch another interview. I'll pitch it for him.
Right, pitch the book for him.
The Ancients, Secret of the Old World seems to have been released in September the 1st, and you've got only 2 reviews. So everyone go read the book and then give him more Amazon reviews so more people will buy it.
There you go. And the link is in the description, by the way, so you can just click there and go right to the book and buy the book right from that. And well, Arthur, I appreciate your time and putting up with this silliness here tonight. We don't usually have a co-host
here. That's what makes it fun.
I appreciate you being here and putting up. You've been a good sport because, you know, I kind of don't want need to bust balls too much. But some of this stuff is kind of out there. I'm sure you're used to people being a little bit surprised by some of the stuff you say now.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Well, I do appreciate your time here and wish you success and good luck. And we'll put the website out there and, again, the link to the description.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thanks. Have a great night.